Cassie?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So, first of all, thank you for the Thomas and the Maxime and everybody. You know, it's very glad to see you, you know, again through the computer. And I'm talking about this subject, hierarchical equation motion approach. And I suppose there weren't so many theoretical talk in this seminar. And theoretical, you know, seminars are rather technical, and because time is not so, time is 30 minutes. So I just want to overview the, you know, idea or, you know, the important thing like that. And actually this hierarchical equation motion approach is now very well used in variety of the area, like a quantum thermodynamics or, you know, the like electric states like that. But I developed this method to calculate 2D or nonlinear spectrum. And actually, you know, the calculating nonlinear spectrum is very tough. And the hierarchical equation motion approach is the only approach, you know, that can create a reasonably well result. So that part I want to explain. First of all, you know, I would like to explain about the model. And so the system bus model. This model has been used a variety of the places, but it works very well in the this society, the spectrum in the condensed phase like that. So the idea is the following. So, you know, it can be any system, but this is like a FMO. So the FMO, so the protein is around and chromophore are inside. And this chromophore is regarded as a system. And like the protein and like absorption are environment and heat bus. Then there is an interaction. So we separate system part and heat bus part. Then the system part is simplified, like a eigenstate representation or like a coordinate space. The other degree of the freedom is expressed by the heat bus. Ensemble of the harmonic oscillator. So it's denoted by X. Then this is a system part, like an Exton case, like this one. And J is a electric state. Then heat bus part is an ensemble of the harmonic oscillator. And this is a system bus interaction. And the bus is characterized by the what called the spectral distribution function, J of omega. And this J of omega, you know, can be obtained rather using the experiment or like a simulation. So that this is one example. So that for each chromophore, the different spectral distribution. And so this environment is actually characterized by this J of omega. Then this model works reasonably well. The reason is that, so this heat bus is a harmonic. So the distribution is Gaussian. And in general, the system inside like a environment. So it's the perturbed by the environment. Then because of the central limiting theorem, the many cases, fluctuation is Gaussian. And this heat bus, harmonic heat bus also produces Gaussian. Therefore it's you know, because of the central limiting theorem, it works very well. Then the treatment, we needed to carefully treat this kind. So that we have to use so-called reduced density matrix. So the instead of the wave function, we have to use a density matrix. Here, the psi is a wave function of the system and heat bus. Q is a system part of the coordinate, and X is a heat bus part, the collective coordinate. And this is the left-hand side wave function, and this is the right-hand side wave function. The equation of motion for this density matrix is like this. This is a quantum Liouville equation. It's equivalent to the Schrödinger equation. So it's a time reversal. Then suppose if you want to measure the like a dipole like this case, it's in the non-polar solution, then dipolar molecule is inside. So when you shine the laser, so you only observe these molecules. And this is a dipole operator of the molecules, only the function of the cube. And this is the expectation value. then you have to make a trace over the system degree of the freedom and the bus degree of the freedom. But then, so this is like here. The point is the following, because the dipole is only the function of the system. So the like here, so this trace B can go through the dipole operator of the system. And this part, I just replaced by this one. This is called the reduced density matrix. And once we reduce the bus degree of the freedom, the dynamics of the this rho A is no longer time reversible. So that it is described like this one. It's called the reduced equation of motion. So then we have a so-called damping operator. So the energy of the system is no longer preserved. And time reversibility is broken. It looks strange because original Hamiltonian, original equation of motion is a time reversal because of this form. And also, energy is conserved. But the reason no longer energy conserved is because this one, we are just looking at this part. So the entire system, the energy is conserved. Also, time evolution is reversible. But because this one, we just looking at here. So the energy of the system is not conserved. And the motion of this is not time reversible because heat bus degree of the freedom is so large, like here. Then so the equation of motion. And you may be familiar with a so-called master equation or a rate field equation. It's like a second order perturbation, like here. So that this is a damping operator. It's a commutator of the system bus interaction. So the second order term. And if you decompose it, this commutator, it consists of the four terms like here. And left, 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 right, 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 and left, right, like here. And this is a expression for the system bus interaction. This is a left-hand side wave function, and this is a right-hand side wave function. And this is a phonon emission and phonon absorption. So H dash is a one interaction, phonon emission, the other is a phonon absorption. And this is like a conjugate of this one. A very special term for this reduced description is this one. So the left-hand side wave function emit the phonon. Then right-hand side wave function absorb. And this is a conjugate. So this is like a communicating the left-hand side wave function and the right-hand side wave function through the system bus interaction. And because of this one, the equation of motion is not the element conjugate. So, and so that there is also the real part like that. And because of this one, we cannot make the like a wave function kind of the description for this one. But anyway, this is a second order perturbation theory, the master equation. And this is a time convolution, this rate field equation. So that, it's the same sort of the equation, but it's more, precisely written like here. But this kind of the equation motion has a strong limitation. The first of all, it is a second order perturbation theory. So that cannot treat a strong system bus interaction. That this equation is actually the non-Markovian, but the problem is a first, or there is a problem, what called the positivity problem. So the population is conserved, but the population of the total population is conserved, but the population of the like excited states or ground states, it sometimes becomes negative. So the population becomes like a ground state population becomes like 1.1, then excited state population becomes minus 0.1, like that. Very strange things. So in order to avoid that kind of the problem, the people usually introduce so-called rotating wave approximation, RWA, and also factorized assumption. But once you make this kind of the assumption, then the fluctuation dispersion theory is broken. So that this term consists of the real term and the imaginary term. And the imaginary term is a fluctuation, thermal fluctuation. If you are familiar with the Langevin equation, that is like a Langevin random force. Then real part is a damping. So the range bound case is a relaxation. And these two terms, you know, relate must satisfy the fluctuation dissipation theorem. Otherwise, the system does not go to the thermal equilibrium states. So this is a limitation of this equation. Then so in order to treat a, you know, strong system bus interaction, we have to take into account a higher order. So this is a fourth order for emission absorption like here, the variety of the diode like here. There are many, many like that. Then now I'm talking about the hierarchical equation of motion. So the hierarchical equation of motion is like a simultaneous differential equation of motion like here. I don't, you know, explain detail, but the point is the following. The why the structure is a hierarchy. The reason is the following. So the hierarchical equation of motion, the zeroth element is contained all order of the system bus interaction. So the it is from the definition, it's contained the second order, fourth order, sixth order, everything. Then the hierarchical equation of motion, I derived by considering the time derivative of this rho zero. Time derivative of the rho zero is actually like showing up like this one, phi rho one, some operator multiply rho one. And this phi rho one has the same order as rho zero, so something like that. But to define the rho one, actually I remove the phi. So the rho one is actually the first order lower than the original. So this one is the diagram is closed, but this is open like here. So this is the lower. Then the second order terms, so that to estimate the row one, I consider the time derivative of the row one, like here. So the time derivative of the row one has a phi row two, and it has the same order as the row one, but to define the row two, actually I remove the phi. Therefore, the row two is a second order lower than the original here. Then the nth order is actually nth order lower than the original. So this is like conceptually, it's quite different from the conventional perturbative approach. Conventional perturbative approach, like a rate field equation, the row zero does not contain any system bus interaction. Then row one contains the second order. Then if you like, you know, row two contains the fourth order. But the hierarchical equation motion, row zero contains everything. So it's exact. Then row one is actually lower than the original. It's the opposite from the conventional perturbative expansion approach. Then this hierarchy, I could construct a hierarchy because this diagram has a same, you know, decaying constant like this. This is for the high temperature case. So for low temperature case, actually we also have to include a temperature correction term, but anyway, like this one. Then point is that for deeper hierarchy, so the decay is faster like here. Actually I can replace by the delta function. They actually truncate this hierarchy. Then I have a set of the hierarchical equation motion, something like that. So this is just a simultaneous equation motion. It's complicated, but I can solve. Then now I'm talking about the why we have to use a hierarchical equation motion to calculate the nonlinear response function. So that for demonstration purpose, here I consider the spin boson system, the very simple. So that the this case, the two-level system and the heat bus, and the system bus coupling like here. So sigma z. Sigma z means the energy fluctuation. And actually, if the system and the interaction is commutable, the time convolutionless rate field works very well, as I showed before. And moreover, actually, we can have an analytical expression of the nonlinear response function. It's the line shape function is showing up. But anyway, I use this as an example for demonstration. This is a spectral distribution. Then as a J of omega, I consider this as a Drude spectral distribution. And this simple function, you know, it's very rich. So if gamma is very large, so that means the correlation time of noise is very short. So it's a fast fluctuation limit here. And if gamma is very small, so the correlation time is long. Therefore, it's slowly modulated. And if the phase of the each oscillation is different, some are high frequency, some are low frequency like here. So this is an inhomogeneous limit. And this is analytical form. So line shape function. So that for this spectral distribution, the line shape function is like this form. And this is a linear absorption spectra. So Fourier transformation of like here. Then for first limit, it's like a Lorentzian. Gamma t, simple decay. Actually, this spectrum is Lorentzian. Then, so like here, this is absorption. Then, for slow modulation case, so the, this case becomes t square. It's actually the Gaussian function. Therefore, like Gaussian. So, for first modulation case, it's called homogeneous limit because everything looks similar. Because so fast, the movement of the each two-level system is much, much faster than observation, laser detection. Then it's averaged, so like a homogeneous, it's a Lorentzian. In homogeneous case, if the movement of the each molecule is much smaller than the observation, laser detection, then it's like a Gaussian. So this is analytical form, but anyway, it is, you know, well known result. Then 2D case, you know, so the first, here is some example. So 2D case, you have a three excitation and one detection. And if T2 is zero, so the excitation like here and the detection here is like a highly correlated, and this representing the resonant peak of each two-level system. So if the modulation is very slow, some are high frequency, some are low frequency. So it's like a distributed like here. So this is T2 equals zero. So then 2D spectrum is like elongated for omega one to omega three axis like here, as you know. Then when T2 becomes larger, so that this one excitation excited to, you know, the molecule is the oscillating. So the it's, you know, the broad like here, then correlation go like here. Then if T2 is very long, so no correlation, circular. So this is very well known. Then calculation. So now I demonstrate, you know, if we simulate this signal using red field equation and the Heilberg regression motion, how it's different. So by the way, this is a homogeneous limit and this is a inhomogeneous and homogeneous. So the, as I showed, there is an analytical solution, response function. And this is a result from the Heilberg regression motion. And the time convolutionless red field equation or generalized red field equation also show that like this one. It's a relatively fast, but slow. So it's like a little bit Lorentzian like Gaussian like here. But anyway, as long as you are calculating linear response, both results are same. So you think, you may think that the time convolutionless master equation is okay for this calculation. But if you calculate a 2D signal, it's very different. So this is a result from the Heilberg regression motion and also the analytical, using analytical solution, we can also same formula here. So it's a first, you know, elongated and become circular. But time convolution red field, you know, it's like a star shape. This star shape means correlation is gone. Then this one is very strange, it's elongated in the omega three direction, it's not physical. So some people actually use like this kind of equation, then try to make this form by using like a sampling. Then at the T2 equals zero, you may make like this one, but if T2 changes, actually it does not go to the circular, but a very strange shape. So the reason this equation cannot reproduce this is the following. So this is a left-hand side wave function, right-hand side wave function. So the excitation, three excitation and one detection. And time convolutionless master equation, these equation use a reduced density matrix like here. Then what happening is when you are solving the time convolution this master equation, it's actually the when you are integrating the second order is like a multiply. So it's, you know, you may find an entanglement like here. So it looks okay, it's non-perturbative effect. This is valid for the case of the sigma's in system bus interaction and the system Hamiltonian is commutable. Only that case, you know, like this one. So if the system part of the interaction, system bus interaction and the system is commutable, that case, you know, you have a response function, analytical solution. Also time convolution function works very well. But any case, so even that, you know, the whenever you apply the laser field like here, so it's not no longer commutable. The system bus interaction and the system Hamiltonian is not commutable. Then it's, you know, back to the second order. So it's like a factorized. For each time you apply the laser field, this expression factorized. But hierarchical equation motion is like here. So, you know, even laser field is applied, so the system bus interaction is goes through like here. And this purple line is actually the source of the echo. So the T1 period and T3 period entangled with the system bus interaction. And hierarchical equation motion can take into account like this kind of the entanglement because as I show, this because this one, these opened diagrams actually, you know, can take into account a system bus entanglement. Therefore, we could have a right result. And so, for the reduced equation motion or for the description of the open quantum dynamics, there are several things, you know. The formulation have to satisfy several things, like a, first of all, like a fluctuation and dissipation. The equation should contain the fluctuation and dissipation. And they must satisfy the fluctuation dissipation theorem. But then the many of the reduced equation motion usually does not satisfy this one because of the rotating wave approximation. And the system bus interaction is also true thermal equilibrium states like here. But the many cases to derive the reduced equation motion, they assume the factorized initial condition. So this is also not satisfied. And the last one is the hardest one. And the many people don't know, you know, that even 1, 2, 3 is satisfied. The fourth one is not, you know, sometimes not satisfied. So here is the, you know, correlation function. You may think this is like a 2D Raman or 2D terrestrial Raman. Excitation, second excitation, detection. Then during the, between the laser interaction, there is a time evolution like here. But the reduced formulation, actually, you know, this is a reduced, the time evolution operator of the reduced one, but this is factorized as I explained like here. That's why it does not satisfy. So, you know, I have been telling about this problem in the Europa, when I stay in the Europa as the Humboldt fellow, then I found there are many physicists who are working on the open quantum dynamics, but then they are using their own formalism, then just calculating like a population decay. Then they don't know, you know, like this kind of problem. So then I created what I called the non-Markovian test. And using analytical solution, so that people can compare their formalism. But so the here is an example. So the red one is analytical solution. And this dashed one is a result from the hierarchical equation motion. So this test one is testing fluctuation, then two is dissipation, then equilibrium states. And last one is actually, you know, the using the analytical expression of the 2D spectrum, then if the formalism can reproduce this one, then everything is passed. But as a reduced equation motion, the hierarchical equation motion is only the equation that can satisfy all of the problem. And path integral Monte Carlo also has the capability to handle all of them, but the formalism is not so convenient to calculate that system under the time-dependent perturbation like here. But anyway, so the hierarchical equation motion have been used a variety of the systems, and here is the perspective. And then I want to explain that I'm running out of time. First, I show the application for the vibrational spectroscopy. And so that here, it's a regular Brownian system, some harmonic potential. But then to explain the vibrational spectroscopy, that we have to include this kind of nonlinear system bus interaction. The reason is the regular Brownian Hamiltonian, it's just a shift oscillator. That kind of interaction does not change the frequency. But if we include this Q square, what happening is like here. So that this Q square, the X is the noise arises from the heat bus. So it has the same form as a frequency. So there is a frequency modulation. But this frequency modulation is controlled by the fluctuation and dissipation. If you only have a fluctuation, so system is heating up, then temperature goes to the infinity. But because of the dissipation, and because of the fluctuation dissipation theorem, it's go to the thermal equilibrium states. And this kind of the model is similar to the stochastic model. Stochastic model, you are fluctuating a level. I just hide it the potential world. So it looks like stochastic. But the stochastic theory, big problem is it ignores the dissipation. Here, stochastic theory only has a fluctuation. So if you use a stochastic theory for this kind of the system described by the coordinate configuration states, it's heating up. You cannot have a right solution. And stochastic theory works reasonably well for the electric excitation. That case, the dissipation, the effect of the dissipation is minor, so it's okay. But for this vibrational spectroscopy, it's not right. And here's an example. This is a MD simulation for the HF. Actually, we did a simulation, then Dwayne Miller said, why did you do this kind of choose this dangerous liquid or something? Because we are theorists, we didn't have any idea. Then after we checked, we're very scared. But anyway, so these are 2D signal of the HF. We choose the HF because it's simple. Then this is MD result. Then we modeled, we tried to reproduce this signal using this simple model. Then for the first modulation case, it's actually time domain T1 and T3, first modulation case like here, slow modulation case like here, just LL, SL, and like here. So usually the form of the system bus interaction or difference of the spectral distribution does not show so much, does not show the difference. So if you are just looking at the population decay, as you can imagine, it's not so easy to find. But the 2D signal is so sensitive, so everything is different. The closest one is this one. This is actually the slowest case like here. So inhomogeneous limit. So we may think this is an inhomogeneous limit. Then another example, so this is a 2D terrestrial Raman signal, and this is the methanol obtained from MD and 2D like here. Then we create a model and choose a parameter to fit the experimental result. Then actually our simple model works reasonably well, like here. And as you might know, reproducing 2D signal is very difficult, So if we had this kind of agreement, I'm very confident, this model describes the essential point of this MD result. And here is the frequency domain. And so as I mentioned, this is a frequency domain. and the same signal. As I mentioned, that this model has a fluctuation and dissipation. And because of the dissipation, the signal is not symmetric. If you are using just that stochastic theory, both are in the same shape. But because of the dissipation, it's not a symmetric. And this is a low frequency case. So the classical calculation works very well. But high frequency case, like intramolecular mode, actually the we have to use a quantum mechanics. And so this signal for high frequency case, as you know, there's a signal for 010 and 012. But if you do the classical case, you know, classical calculation, there is no excitation energy level. So does not look like here. So it's completely different. So the high frequency case, we have to use a quantum calculation like here. And that kind of things also can be done using a hierarchical equation motion approach, because we have a classical form and quantum. Then now I'm talking about electric excitation. So I was talking about the vibrational spectroscopy, but now I'm talking about electric excitation. And our goal is studying like this one. So, you know, there are rich physics like here. Then we want to calculate the 2D signal. Then I consider rather simple extension. So suppose we have like a multi energy state like here. So 1, 2, 3 levels. So the Hamiltonian is like here. Ground states like here. Excited state like here. And third state like here. Then laser excitation. Laser excitation is actually, you know, I can put in this Hamiltonian. It's like a off-diagonal interaction. And Q can be depend upon the molecular configuration. So like a non-conductive or something, and it can be time dependent. Then non-adiabatic coupling is actually as a function of the coordinate. And the non-adiabatic coupling is also an off-diagonal element for this one. The non-adiabatic coupling between the 1 and 3 is actually here. So this Hamiltonian is actually like here. So the diagonal part is a potential and off diagonal part is a time dependent function. Then also that can be the function of the cube. So this is a Hamiltonian. Then if we extend the ground states, you know, not just a phase space, but like a 3 by 3 matrix, then just to solve this model, then we can calculate a nonlinear spectrum for any shape of the potential like here. So this is the hierarchical equation motion for the multi-state. So now the distribution function is like a matrix like here. Then here's one example. So the Dr. Ikeda, when he was my student, so he did this. So these are the two potential energy surfaces. So this is just a dynamics, wave packet go like here. And using hierarchical equation motion, we can solve like this one. Then at the same time, we calculated the 2D signal. So this case, you know, 2D electric spectroscopy, and this part is a 2D vibration spectroscopy. Then the you know quotient type. He said this is not a 2D EVS because you know ES is also here. Then he gave a name 2D everything spectroscopy. You know, it does not exist, but anyway, this is a spectrum. So then, so if we change the T2, what's happening is you know movement of the wave packet like here is going like here. Then it's separated. Then the wave packet is separated here. Then going here, then some are going back and going back. So the you know we can simulate like this one. So this is a single potential surfaces, surface, that a one-dimensional potential surface. But the interesting dynamics is two-dimensional, like avoided crossing and the conical intersection surface. And the you know it's a computationally very expensive, but we are gradually reach this state. And here is like an example for this two-dimensional potential surface. One is with conical intersection. The other is avoided crossing. For this case, actually, we could calculate like a pump probe and 2D ES plus 2D EVS or something like this. It's actually unpublished before I finished. Dr. Ikeda moved to some other place, so could not finish. But anyway, we can do it now. And so the almost time is gone. But anyways, our latest, you know, result. So the Juyon actually did the something. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I will finish soon. But it is just advertisement. So the single beam spectrally controlled 2D Raman spectroscopy. We did a simulation for this one. And another thing is the machine learning approach. We created the system bus model. Actually, Thomas and Luane studied like this kind of things. So we constructed the system bus model using machine learning approach, then calculated the 2D signal here. And the last one is a proton coupled electron transfer problem. So this kind of we are working on. And yeah, I think I should skip, but anyway, we are also applying the hierarchical equation motion approach to the quantum thermodynamics. And actually we found that the Jaroszynski equality is not valid, not justified in the quantum case, actually. Then the reason is the definition of the entropy. Many people using a von Neumann entropy or von Neumann entropy, but that's not the right entropy to study. Then we found, you know, the right Helmholtz energy should be defined like here. Then the entropy can be calculated like here. Then the system bus model actually satisfy the first law of the thermodynamics and second law of the thermodynamics. It's, you know, it took 30 years, but I'm very, you know, satisfied. You know, that this system bus model, so total energy is conserved. That, however, that there's a time irreversibility, and the temperature is also defined. But then, you know, it's satisfied like here. Then point is that this quasi-static Helmholtz energy, you know, you may familiar with this form. This is a polarizability. And if rho A is a regular density matrix, so you see that, so this means that if the you gradually at, part of the system, we can estimate the free energy using the optical, response. So, then, it's probably not necessary to do the 2D spectroscopy, but we can study, instead of the Jaroszynski formula, we can simply observe here. Anyway, the remark is, it's very simple. The hierarchical equation motion is very convenient. However, it's numerically very expensive. That is a limitation. But the computer is getting strong, and GPU or something, or another numerical method, it's, it's gradually extending the possibility. And at the end, I would like to thank you for the all people. And here is Charles Mukamel in the hot spring. And Graham Fleming with sake. And Duane Miller with soba noodle. And I think Mifa Cho with some Korean spicy food. Peter Ham is here. Hon Shenta is an African mountain. And Jan Shu is, and Maxim is also here. So anyway, thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Yoshitaka. We have time for a few questions. It's one of the panelists that's raising their hand.
Oh, I would have a question, Taka.
Yeah.
You said at some point if a model includes obeys fluctuation dissipation theorem, then 2D line shapes become asymmetrically positive negative mm-hmm. band. Mm-hmm. We observe in experiment that basically they're always asymmetric, and I must say I never really understood. So that's why.
Yeah. Because the population changes.
You have a physical picture beyond equations, why this would make it asymmetric, I
don't. Sure. It's a rather simple story. Let me see. Suppose if you have a three-level system, one is a 0, 1, 0, the other is a 0, 1, 2.
Yeah.
Then if the population does not change, both 1, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 1, 2, it's the same. However, because of the relaxation, population changes. So 012 and 0010 is not same. That's why. Also, profile changes because coherence is different.
So what, I mean, let me ask the question the other way around. So if I were to provide you a 2D spectrum, which is strongly asymmetric, mm-hmm. which I have many,
mm-hmm.
what would you do with it?
Yeah, so, you know,
what would be the conclusions you can extract from it?
Yeah, the relaxation is very important. Or thermal effect, I may say. And I think that your signal might be relatively low frequency. Like mm-hmm. at most like 1,000 or 1,500 wave number.
Yeah.
If the 3,000 or higher, probably symmetric. Because dissipation is not so important.
Well, we observe this universally always, not only at low frequency modes.
Yeah, I also observe the way.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question for Peter and Tucker in a way. So Peter, can you explain the asymmetry that you're talking about, please?
Well, that the 0-1 band and the 1-2 band,
right?
Typically the 1-2 band is weaker and mm-hmm. also more stretched,
mm-hmm.
more diffuse. Good. That's a yep. very common observation.
It is. I thought you understood it and I didn't.
No, I don't understand it.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Okay.
But it only has to be the same in the Hamming approximation, right? So.
Yes, I mean, that's typically the starting point of the discussion. It has to be the same in the harmonic approximation. And then, of course, I always said without thinking, it's not strictly harmonic, so this explains it. But I was never
fully
happy with that statement. And what Taka just said is the first time I heard this.
Are you sure? I have
been. It's an interesting aspect.
Okay. I have been telling you probably more than 10 years.
Probably, yes. Probably. Yes.
Other questions?
By the way, I forgot to mention the if you like to have this PowerPoint, the PowerPoint lecture note is on my homepage. And also if you like this, the PDF, the PowerPoint file, I also send it to you.
Maybe I can add a question. If I would like to do a calculation of a 2D spectrum using the hierarchy equation of motion, mm-hmm. How would you recommend me to do that? Is there any software that would be available?
Yeah, the Dr. Ikeda provided. I think it's like a JCTC, well known. And also in my homepage, simple one is also post it on my homepage. But this multi energy level system is relatively easy to calculate. But this kind of the system is quite difficult because we have to choose the right mesh and a right time step here. And the program is highly optimized for the GPU or something. But anyway, the program is available.
Okay, I think Chris Cheatham also has a question.
So, Taka, beautiful talk. You may have just answered my question right there at the end, but I'll ask it anyway. Your slide said that the solving these equations is computationally expensive. And of course, like fast, that's a pretty relative term. It depends on who you're talking to, how much that matters. And so I'm curious what you mean by numerically expensive. And in particular, is it sufficiently amenable to parallelization? You know, can I take advantage of all the GPU processors my university is running? Because if I can, then maybe I don't care so much.
So first of all, I should say, you know, almost all calculation like this one is used, you know, our computer. And I'm a rather poor theorist, so I don't have so many computer. So like a GPU, like a cost like $3,000 or something. You know, if you have a computer with a GPU, then you may calculate like here. And but you know, the problem of calculating 2D signal is you have to change T2, right? Then for different T2, we have to repeat. If you have a parallel computer, you can calculate like a 10 or 20 T2 at once. That's a big advantage.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay. I think maybe in view of time, we should thank Yoshitaka again.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And...